Hello everyone, welcome to the lecture video of System Software and Compilers Module 2. In this lecture, let us look at the role of lexical analyzer and the input buffering. Lexical analysis reads characters from left to right and groups into tokens. A simple way to build a lexical analyzer is to construct a diagram to illustrate the structure of tokens of the source program. We can also produce a lexical analyzer automatically by specifying the lexeme patterns to a lexical analyzer generator and compiling those patterns into code that functions as a lexical analyzer. This approach makes it easier to modify a lexical analyzer since we have only to rewrite the affected patterns, not the entire program. The speed of the lexical analysis is a concern in compiler design, since only this phase reads the source program character by character. The role of lexical analyzer. As the first phase of a compiler, the main task of the lexical analyzer is to read the input characters of the source program group them into lexemes and produce a output as a sequence of tokens for each lexeme in the source program. The stream of tokens is sent to the parser for syntax analysis. It is common for the lexical analyzer to interact with the symbol table as well. When the lexical analyzer discovers a lexeme constituting an identifier, it needs to enter that lexeme into the symbol table. In some cases, information regarding the kind of identifier may be read from the symbol table by the lexical analyzer to assist it in determining the proper token it must pass to the parser. These interactions are shown in the figure. Commonly, the interaction is implemented in a way that the parser calls the lexical analyzer. Parser, by this call with the get the next token command, makes the lexical analyzer to read characters from its input until it can identify the next lexeme and produce for it the next token, which it returns to the parser. Since the lexical analyzer is the part of the compiler that reads the source program, it may perform certain other tasks in addition to the identification of lexemes. One such task is to remove the comments and white spaces like a blank, new line, tab, and perhaps the other characters that are used to separate the tokens in the input program. Another task is to correlating the error messages generated by the compiler with the source program. For instance, the lexical analyzer may keep track of the number of new line characters seen so that it can associate a line number with each error message. In some compilers, the lexical analyzer makes a copy of the source program with the error messages inserted at the appropriate positions. If the source program uses a macro preprocessor, the expansion of macros may also be performed by the lexical analyzer. Sometimes lexical analyzers are divided into a sequence of two processes, scanning and lexical analysis. Scanning consists of the simple processes that do not require tokenization of the input, such as deletion of comments and compaction of consecutive whitespace characters into one. Lexical analysis is the more complex portion where the scanner produces the sequences of tokens as output. There are a number of reasons why the analysis portion of the compiler is normally separated into lexical analysis and parsing phases. Simplicity of design is the most important consideration. The separation of lexical and syntactic analysis often allows us to simplify at least one of these tasks. For example, a parser that had to deal with comments and white space as syntactic units would be considerably more complex than one that can assume comments and white spaces have already been removed by the lexical analyzer. If we are designing a new language, separating lexical and syntactic concerns can lead to a cleaner overall language design. Compiler efficiency is improved. A separate lexical analyzer allows us to apply specialized techniques that serve only the lexical task, not the job of parsing. In addition, the specialized buffering techniques for reading input characters can speed up the compiler significantly. Compiler portability is enhanced. Input device specific peculiarities can be restricted to the lexical analyzer. Tokens, patterns, and lexemes. A token is a pair consisting of a token name and an optional attribute value. The token name is an abstract symbol representing a kind of lexical unit. Example, a particular keyword or a sequence of output characters denoting an identifier. The token names are the input symbols that the parser processes. For example, ID is the token name, ID is the token name, and pointer to symbol table entry for E is the optional attribute value. Like that, if the number is given in the program, then it matches with the token number, so the token name will be a number and its value will be the optional attribute value, so it will be a integer value 2. A pattern is a description of the form that the lexemes of a token may take. In the case of a keyword as a token, the pattern is just the sequence of characters that form the keyword. For identifiers and some other tokens, the pattern is a more complex structure that is matched by many strings. A lexeme is a sequence of characters in the source program that matches the pattern for a token and is identified by the lexical analyzer as an instance of that token. For example, count, temp, 389, 3.189, all these are lexemes. Attributes for tokens. When more than one lexeme can match a pattern, the lexical analyzer must provide the subsequent compiler phases additional information about the particular lexeme that matched. For example, the pattern for token number matches both 0 and 1, but it is extremely important for the code generator to know which lexeme was found in the source program. Thus, in many cases, the lexical analyzer returns to the parser not only a token name but an attribute value that describes the lexeme represented by the token. The token name influences parsing decisions, while the attribute value influences translation of tokens after the parse. We shall assume that tokens have at most one associated attribute, although this attribute may have a structure that combines several pieces of information. The most important example is the token ID, where we need to associate with the token a large amount of information. Normally, information about an identifier, for example, its lexeme, its type, and the location at which it is first found, is kept in the symbol table. Because in case an error message about that identifier must be issued, thus the appropriate attribute value for an identifier is a pointer to the symbol table entry for that identifier. The token names and associated attribute values for the Fortran statement E equals MC square is written as a sequence of pairs. In the certain pairs, especially for operators, punctuation, and keywords, there is no need for an attribute value. In this example, the token number has been given an integer valued attribute. In practice, a typical compiler would instead store a character string representing the constant and use as an attribute value for the number a pointer to that string. Lexical errors. It is hard for a lexical analyzer to tell without the aid of other components that there is a source code error. For instance, if the string fi is encountered for the first time in a C program in the context, if the program fragment is if a is equal to 50 and if it is wrongly typed as fi a is equal to 50. A lexical analyzer cannot tell whether fi is a misspelling of the keyword if or an undeclared function identifier. Since fi is a valid lexeme for the token id, the lexical analyzer must return the token id to the parser and let some other phases of the compiler, probably the parser in this case, handle an error due to the transposition of the letters. However, suppose a situation arises in which the lexical analyzer is unable to proceed because none of the patterns for tokens matches any prefix of the remaining input. The simplest recovery strategy is panic mode recovery. We delete successive characters from the remaining input until the lexical analyzer can find a well-formed token at the beginning of what input is left. This recovery technique may confuse the parser, but in an interactive computing environment, it may be quite adequate. The other possible error recovery actions are delete one character from the remaining input, insert a missing character into the remaining input, replace a character by another character, transpose two adjacent characters. Transformations like these may be tried in an attempt to repair the input. The simplest such strategy is to see whether a prefix of the remaining input can be transformed into a valid lexeme by a single transformation. This strategy makes sense since in practice, most lexical errors involve a single character. A more general correction strategy is to find the smallest number of transformations needed to convert the source program into one that consists only of valid lexemes. But this approach is considered too expensive in practice to be worth the effort. Input buffering. Let us examine some ways that the simple but very important task of reading the source program can be speeded. This task is made difficult by the fact that we often have to look one or more characters beyond the next lexeme before we can be sure we have the right lexeme. Because of the amount of time taken to process characters and the large number of characters that must be processed during the compilation of a large source program, Specialized buffering techniques have been developed to reduce the amount of overhead required to process a single input character. An important scheme involves two buffers that are alternatively reloaded, as shown in figure. Each buffer is of the same size n, and n is usually the size of a disk block, example 4096 bytes. Using one system read command, we can read n characters into a buffer rather than using one system call per character. If fewer than n characters remain in the input file, then a special character represented by EOF, that is end of file, marks the end of the source file and is different from any possible character of the source program. Two pointers to the input are maintained. First one, pointer lexem begin, that marks the beginning of the current lexem whose extent we are attempting to determine. Second one is for pointer, that scans ahead until a pattern match is found. Once the next lexem is determined, forward is set to the character at its right end. Then, after the lexem is recorded as an attribute value of a token returned to the parser, lexem begin is set to the character immediately after the lexem just found. In the figure, we see forward has passed the end of the next lexem, that is double star, which is a Fortran exponentiation operator, and must be retracted one position to its left. Advancing forward requires that we first test whether we have reached the end of one of the buffers, and if so, we must reload the other buffer from the input and move forward to the beginning of the newly loaded buffer. If we use the scheme previously as described, we must check each time when we advance the forward pointer that we have not moved off one of the buffers. If we do, then we must also reload the other buffer. So, for each character read, we make two tests. One for the end of the buffer and one to determine what character is read. We can combine the buffer end test with the test for the current character if we extend each buffer to hold a sentinel character at the end. The sentinel is a special character that cannot be a part of a source program, and a natural choice is the character EOF, end of file. Figure shows the same arrangement as previous figure, but with sentinels added. Here, EOF retains its use as a marker for the end of the entire input. Any EOF that appears other than at the end of a buffer means that the input is at an end. The algorithm shown summarizes for advancing the forward pointer. See how the first test, which can be part of a multi-way branch, based on the character pointed to by the forward pointer, is the only test we make. Except in the case where we actually are at the end of a buffer or the end of the input.